Hi, this is Stelios from the TESSERACT Academy, and in this short video, we're going to be talking about tokenomics. Blockchain is one of the most popular buzzwords in technology right now, alongside AI and big data. Blockchain is a relatively new invention. The Bitcoin ledger started in 2009, and Ethereum started in 2015. However, it's rapidly expanding and evolving. It's impossible to check the technology news and not see about new startups in blockchain coming out all the time in all kinds of different areas. So we have from insurance to agriculture to AI, anything. And even though Ethereum, which allowed the creation of ICOs, is relatively recent, so far startups have raised billions using this technology. And so this is just to show you the importance that blockchain right now has in the world of technology. So what's an ICO? I assume that most people watching this video already know what an ICO is. But for those of you who are not familiar with the term, ICO stands for initial coin offering. So this means that you are creating a token, virtual currency, and you want to get funded, and you don't go this through the traditional way. Rather, you ask for Ethereum or Bitcoin in exchange for your token, right? So you give your users a token, and then you get in exchange Ethereum or Bitcoin, and then you can convert this to fiat, like a normal currency such as USD, dollars, and then you can use this to fund your venture. So this is a very powerful concept, first of all, because from a regulatory perspective and from a technological perspective, it democratized funding in startups even more. That's one. Secondly, there's a very interesting idea which not everyone has captured behind ICOs, and this is that by issuing a token, a startup and a business effectively creating a kind of artificial economy, which means that you can reward users with tokens based on arbitrary kinds of incentives. So to give you an example, there's Filecoin that tokens represent megabytes in a hard drive space, or you have environmental tech startups that reward users with tokens for producing clean energy, or you can have health apps where they reward users for participating in health activities. So there are different types of tokens. There are two main types, the security tokens and the utility tokens. The security tokens for those companies that are in the States and possibly for many other companies are a no-no, because security tokens effectively represent assets such as dividends, and they're basically like equities or bonds, etc., which means that in the States they are treated the same way as dividends, and this means they need to be regulated. There are some countries where regulation right now is a gray area, and it's really not recommended to try and create a security token unless you really know what you're doing and you have the right legal team to support you through this process of understanding how to be compliant with the regulations. The utility tokens, on the other hand, offer goods and services to the users that basically want to interact with the business, right? So maybe a business is selling goods, and instead of just accept like US dollars, they accept tokens. Or maybe if you hold these tokens, maybe you get some premium service, or maybe you get a special discount, etc. So utility tokens are not going to provide you with dividends or equity or anything of that sort, but they're effectively a medium of exchange for this closed economy represented by the business. So since we are talking about the creation of these like virtual economies, essentially, the question that arises is, how can we govern these economies, right? So this is when tokenomics comes into play. Also, there's another word called cryptoeconomics, whereas cryptoeconomics mainly refers to the incentives for the participants of blockchain networks, okay, for example, for the miners, whereas tokenomics mainly refers, in most cases, to the economy of this closed world. And there are many questions that need to be answered in this setting, such as, you know, in the real economy, the central bank cares about setting the interest rates, or when a company decides to run an IPO, an initial public offering, and they need to think about how many shares to issue, etc. Similar questions arise in this context, right? For example, how many tokens should I issue if I'm a blockchain startup? How can I set up the right incentive structure so the token will appreciate in value? And why is this important? Because if someone buys a token during the ICO stage, it's very likely they see this as an investment and they want some assurance that this is going to raise in value in the future. How can I control some factors of the economy, such as the inflation or the volatility? I mean, volatility can be beneficial, but too much volatility can make the system collapse. It's the same with inflation. And finally, user incentives. And these user incentives are also tied to the business model, right? How can I create the right incentives for my users so they actually want to use the token? Okay, but also this adds some value to their lives. There are some common fallacies that take place. Obviously, that's a huge topic and this is a short video, so we can't cover all of these. But these are some of the most common ones I've seen. A very common fallacy is using tokens as a replacement for fiat. So for example, let's say you come up with an idea to create some kind of online retailer for online shopping. You know, you just sell products, and instead of accepting just fiat currencies such as USD or euros, you say, you know what, I'm gonna issue my own tokens. And the question there is, okay, so does your token really offer any value? Or is it just another layer of complexity added on top of your business without any real value? Another mistake I've seen is what many startups have done in the past, and they still do, is run ICOs with a limited number of tokens, okay? And then these tokens are burned gradually. And the theory behind this is that when you are burning tokens, then they will appreciate in value eventually because you are limiting the supply of the tokens. And this is not a very good idea, actually, because it doesn't really help the long-term viability of the project. And then there are some other more, let's say, technical matters that need to be taken care of, such as the right auction mechanism for an IPO. So Gnosis, and you can see the link here from Vitalik Buterin's blog. This is a very interesting use case. They use the reverse Dutch auction mechanism, which backfired a bit, leading them to 90% of their tokens not being sold. They had to come up with a new solution after the ICO as to how to manage the economy, effectively holding the tokens and then redistributing them, etc. But the important thing here is not what these people did, what Gnosis did. The purpose of this example is to just demonstrate to you how things such as the auction mechanisms need to be very carefully chosen, and sometimes they can backfire. Then quite often, because all these things are new, all right, so for 90% of tokenomics, there's nothing really out there. We're just trying to do things by stealing tools from traditional economics. Sometimes things backfire, and then solutions have to be found on the fly. So there are some other considerations around ICOs. One is whether you should go for a hard cap or a soft cap. Other issues is the actual number of tokens that should be issued, which I think research is currently providing. I mean, seems to agree that it's not a very important question, the actual number of tokens. As long as it's a large number, it's not really going to make much of a difference. Then another question is how much the percentages as to how the tokens from the ICO should be distributed. Some is obviously going to founders, some percentage is going to bounty programs, etc. Or even how to structure an ICO in the sense that do you want an ICO that's all going to happen in one stage, or are you going to have like a pre-sale, then maybe multiple stages of the public offering? And finally, whether another question is whether you should make the token compliant with the Ethereum blockchain or whether you want to create something new from scratch. And this is just, you know, scratching the surface. There are many, many more questions that need to be answered in this context. And also there are some legal issues. I already mentioned some of the complications around legal issues and security tokens. So I'm a big fan personally of agent-based modeling, and this is something I have also promoted in my personal blog. I do believe that because tokenomics is a new field and it's very difficult to study, and we're facing many unknowns and many nonlinear and complex interactions between entities such as the users of the system and or the speculators in a market, etc. I do believe that agent-based modeling can be a very good tool that can help us study tokenomics. Since we are not driven so much by theory at this stage of tokenomics research, why not just use an agent-based model that lets us explicitly code all the assumptions behind our system or closed economy and see how it unfolds? So I'm a big fan of this technique. You can read more about it on my blog, and it would also be very good to have your comments on that.